Good evening, everybody. Today our topic will be on Egypt. And almost now it's 5 years since the Tahrir revolt in Egypt. And the idea is that it is to bring this very important country. Egypt is the eighth important country in the world. Egypt is not a normal country. Maybe the media can speak about Egypt in a very shallow way, but Egypt is one of the eight very important countries in the world, and it is also important for the Arab world as Germany to European Union. Egypt is the German of the Arab world. First, I will explain Egypt's position in the world in order to understand why external forces for the last 100 years and something intervened in that country to stop Egypt to walk a normal walk. Egypt, it have an influence, and a very strong influence in the Arab world, one. Secondly, Egypt also have a very big influence on the African continent. Egypt also have a very strong influence on the countries of the Mediterranean. Egypt also have an influence in the Islamic world. Fifth, Egypt also, as had played at one time, it can play in the world balance of forces with the third world being as the vanguard, as it happened in the past, in the 50s, the Bandung, and then non-aligned movement. So Egypt is not a normal country. Egypt is a very, very important country. Important for peoples and countries who wanted to be independent from the clash and the domination of imperialism. At the same time, Egypt is a very old country, highly civilized country. Egypt, it's not Belgium. Egypt is not Germany. Egypt is deeply cultured society, a very big history. I will not go there of the 4,000 years of Egyptian history. I will only touch certain important elements in their history. Egypt before Islam, a little bit, and how Egypt later on became Muslim. And after that, immediately I will go to the modern Egypt. And that modern Egypt is created by Muhammad Ali, and later on is crushed. In detail we will discuss about that. Secondly, Egypt from defeat after Muhammad Ali and the imposition of the British, his son Ismail Khedive, until 1879-1882. In the between, that it is the Suez Canal, which is a French project by its inception, but later on British capital dominated, which makes Egypt even more important. Then the First World War and the impact of the inter-imperialist war on Egypt, a little bit in India, because they represent the same. And after that, the Egyptian independence, so-called Egypt, from being British colony indirectly, but also independent or turning into a semi-colony in 1922. Then we will speak about the class position of the Egyptians. Who are they, these Egyptians? How many percent they are peasant? Who owns the land? Who owns the factories? Who are these classes in Egypt? In Egypt, they are Egyptians, but there are also class differences in Egypt. And what is the new modern political parties representing Egypt, particularly from 1920s until 1952, the emergence of the Muslim Brotherhood, the emergence of the Egyptian Communist Party, and these two we will discuss. And then finally, 1952 until 1970, the overthrow of the Egyptian kingdom or the royal family and the other local classes, and the emergence of popular democracy on the basis of the officers who have taken the power in Egypt under Nasser, and what achievement Egypt have realized from 1952 until his days in 1970. And then we will discuss 1970, that Egypt retreated, and the result of retreat of Egypt because of internal enemy took over the power in alliance with imperialism, and what effect it had on Africa, in the world, on the Arab world, we will discuss that, until the downfall of Mubarak and the popular revolt. And then we will come, who influenced the popular revolt, who are the forces there, how many parties, which classes are competed, and then why now the army took over. And the new technology also, which have brought for Egypt also a lot of wells is now discovered in Egypt, all this role. And we will also speak in between the role of Israel and the Zionist ideology, how it came, why they have occupied Palestine, from what experience that the British took over. We will little bit in detail, we will double about that. And then we will discuss. This is a very important country. And I want you that it is next time when you read about this country, you have to think twice because it is very important. Egypt is pregnant. At one time there was the spark happened 5 years ago, but that spark still now in the womb of the mother, Egypt. At any time this baby will be born. And there is forces who want to abolish or to create abortion to this baby. But Egypt is also, as the Arabs they say, in the Burkan of revolution. Egypt again will surprise us very soon. In Egypt, the contradiction is very, very big. First of all, I will start from the French Revolution. French Revolution is the only authentic revolution in the European history and also in the world history. French Revolution, after the revolution happened, it had to defend itself. And it went out of France. And it had to fight against the reactionary forces in Europe. The reactionary forces in Europe, most of European countries, they were feudal states. The only country which had an access and had a possibility, by accident of history, developed a modern industry, particularly textile industry, was Great Britain. Great Britain wanted to be alone in the world, and she wants all humanity in the world to be consumer of British goods, particularly the textile industry. Normally, industries first starts in textile, and then finally they will be refined and they go to other, once you have textile, the embryo of chemical industry will be born. And once the embryo of chemical industry is born, then you can also make agricultural revolution because you create also a lot of fertilizers and so on, and you produce, towns grow, big cities grow. After the French Revolution, that Europe had 100 cities. Paris, before the French Revolution, it was a filthy, small village of the Middle Ages. The historian, the Marxist historian, the late Eric Hobsbawm, in his book of Age of Revolution, in the introduction he says, if Muhammad Ali of Egypt have succeeded in his journey, then today we will not be discussing about Egypt. History of humanity had been totally different. Probably capitalism could have grown in Egypt, and probably in that part of the world, and maybe we will see history differently. Unfortunately, Britain knew that. And Britain wanted to stop anybody who wants to make a journey the way she did. Britain first, internally, after the Roses War, it defeated the peasantry. the English aristocracy and bourgeoisie, defeated and kicked out millions of peasants from their land and brought them into shanty towns, which later on there would be workers without any rights in the textile industry. Friedrich Engels, in his one of major work, he writes the British working class history. It is a wonderful book. I advise you to read that. The condition of the working class in Great Britain. He's analyzing how these peasantry have been chased away. They have nothing except to sell their labor. And they are in fact modern slaves. In order to survive, children, women, pregnant women, name it what it is, in a miserable, even worse than the slaves who are in southern part of United States. Slave, you buy it. A slave is like a tractor, even better than a tractor. When you buy a slave, he produces for you, and if you are in a crisis of money or you are in problem of finance, you can sell the slave, which you will get money out of it. So because of slave is a means of production, you maintain him, you give him a lot of food. You don't want your slave to die. The slave produce, and you live on the slave's capacity. Thirdly, the slave, the only slave, which produce also other slaves. Tractors, they don't produce other tractors, but slave can produce also children. And these children, by de facto, they become your slave. So the condition of the slaves in United States, according to Lenin, in one of his major articles, Shame on America on the Plight of Negro. It is one of the wonderful analyses he made on the United States. He says that when he compares that the slaves of United States, the grade of literacy, who can read and write, it was much better than the peasant of Russia. The slaves could read statistically better than the peasant of Russia, just to give you the condition of slaves. The British working class was in a very miserable. That's why lately the British working class finally have to organize themselves. The charities movement came and so on. I will not go deep, and then later on how it is syndicalism came, then later on social democracy and so on. Today what we are now. We will go back to Egypt. Egypt was a colony, you could say, or dominated by the Holy Roman Empire, the Eastern Holy Roman Empire, which is the Byzantine, and their capital is Constantinople. What is that? Constantinople, before the Turk took it over. Lenin says imperialism existed in a lot of ages of humanity. The only difference of imperialism on the basis of capitalism, it is another type of imperialism based on a new economic system. The Byzantine imperialists, they are peasant system, Byzantine economy. They dominate the whole region from Syria, Egypt, and all this. And they only ask tributary, that these regions have to pay certain taxation in a year. As a result of that, nationalism at that moment was manifested on the basis of churches, is not on the basis of the one we know now. Two churches defected and rejected the Byzantine domination, which is the Greeks. The first one is the Armenian Church. The Armenian Church defected and rejected the domination of the Byzantine, which is the Greeks, against the Greek domination. The second is the Egyptian Coptic Church. The Byzantine power, it took them 350 years to suppress and to stop the revolt of the Egyptians and sometimes also the revolt of Armenians. In between, the Byzantine was also getting weaker and weaker, and new concept and new ideology, if you want to call it, or a new religion appeared, which is Islam. Islam in the fastest rate it grew, and then it reaches at the border of Armenia. Armenian ruling class and Armenian aristocracy and Armenian church allied with Islam against the Byzantine. On the other side, the Egyptian Coptic Church invited the Muslims to come and to help them in Egypt. Walid ibn As, the general who was supposed to go to Egypt, it is in the time of the Caliph Umar, the third Caliph, the second Caliph, when he told him, Egypt is a highly civilized country. We have new ideas, but we have no civilized culture as Egypt. Take care and do something reasonable, he tells him. Cairo Canal was closed for almost 30 years because of the conflict they had with the Byzantine, and there was a lot of malaria, and in fact reduced the population of Cairo by almost two-thirds. And Cairo was deserted. It was a small village, but was deserted. The Muslim troops, when they came, the first thing they did is they cleaned the Cairo Canal to show by example that they have an either higher concept. They cleaned the Cairo Canal, which is, means also they cleaned mosquito breeding areas, which is malaria was attacking a lot of people and killing, and bilharzia for that matter. And gradually, Egypt became majority Muslim. This is the way that Egypt became and joined Islam. Now we will go to the modern history of Egypt. Before I mention about the modern history of Egypt, I have to mention for you two anecdotes. The reason the imperialist, British imperialist, the way they create difficulties in the shoes of these countries to walk normally. I want you to keep this in your mind, because while I'm talking later on, we will trace certain examples which are today also still exist, and that you can reconnect them with what happened. When India wants to get independence, and India was the jowl of the British colonialism, Britain envisaged communalism. India must be divided. United India, Muslim and Hindus, they will not only catch up, but they will pass us, and there will be a very big power. We have to do our homework, they said. The far-sighted British colonialist, the first thing they introduced after the British, after the Indian concept of independence was in the embryo level and it is growing, the first thing they introduced is that communal election for local administration under the colony. And they said that it is, this election must be based on communalism, which is means on the basis of religion, Muslims and Hindus. And this is the embryo of the difficulties that they have created for India, greater India, Pakistan didn't exist, Bangladesh didn't exist, that India will, if it gets independence, will not walk properly in a faster straight. You have to limit her walking speed. This created a sentiment, the Hindu bourgeoisie on one side, the emerging Islamic bourgeoisie, Muslim bourgeoisie is on the other side, and finally, they were divided, and India was divided into two states, Pakistan, East Pakistan and West Pakistan, and the other India became India. And the other India, Indian nationalists, led by Gandhi, Nehru and others, have to sign a document with the British. The British created inside India 100 independent princely states. That independent India must recognize them as an independent sovereign countries. 100 inside India, Rajasthan and so on and so on and so on. Of course, the wise Prime Minister of India, Indira Gandhi, slowly, with a very good understanding of the problem, she abolished these states, and then we see now what is India. The British, while they were fighting against the French Revolution, mobilized all the feudal states, including Prussia, to fight against the French Revolution. Finally, 16 feudal states mobilized their army, and they battled in our country, Belgium, in Waterloo, and defeated Napoleon. The revolution was defeated in Belgium. Revolution, counter-revolution. In fact, they call it restoration. And this time, a man who one time he was an Ottoman soldier, later on he became also a tobacco businessman, an Albanian origin, because Albanians under the Ottoman, they had only one profession. Because of their mountainous character of their region, big part of the Ottoman soldiers come from Albanians and also converted Serbs. Muhammad Ali is from an Albanian origin, who later on became officer and then became also wali or province leader of Egypt. But he was a very, very, very intelligent man who have understood after Napoleon, before it is defeat, invaded Egypt, and Egypt, the French Revolution introduced three important things. One, the code of modern administration. Second, the concept of modern education. Third, the concept of modern agriculture. This have created a sort of a movement in Egypt. Muhammad Ali, after he took over the power, using these three elements, and he wanted to modernize Egypt from inside. One concept of him is that Egypt must be a self-sufficient in agriculture, and he has to modernize agriculture as much as possible. To modernize agriculture, you need agricultural tools. You have to transform the agricultural tools. And the transformation of agricultural tools must be on the basis of a modern technique and a modern equipment. So he established the steel industry. When a country has a steel industry, it's over. Nobody can stop her, unless you invade it and you kill all the people there. A steel industry is the mother or the backbone of all industries. And if you have a steel industry, you can transform yourself also from a steel industry into to defend your country with a modern military equipment. So the three important organs which the French Revolution built in France, he copied that and he wanted to implement that. Great Britain, after they defeated Napoleon in Waterloo, they turned back. They turned back and they brought a new slogan. In the name of protecting the Ottoman, we will protect the Ottoman Imperium from secession. Muhammad Ali is a secessionist. Muhammad Ali, in the process, he occupied Khartoum. He is the founder. In fact, he is the one who created the city Khartoum. Khartoum means Khartoum in Arabic, where the two rivers, the Blue Nile and the White Nile, they meet in Omdurman, and it looks like the elephant teeth when they meet, the two rivers. And Khartoum means is the elephant teeth. And he expanded until Eritrea in Massawa, and he had also an influence in Yemen. He occupied greater Syria, Palestine, Syria, and so on, and he was creating a bigger market. Nationalism is based on a bigger market or on a market. He wanted to create a new nation on the basis of a new market, and if that market exists, then the economic dynamic of that country will be stronger and stronger, and that country cannot be stopped. Britain, in the name of coming back to Muhammad Ali, it defeated Muhammad Ali finally. It organized 17 feudal states in the name of protecting the Ottoman, and they defeated Muhammad Ali militarily. They defeated him in Palestine, they defeated him in Syria, they defeated him also in another part. A lot of battles happened between the British and their protege, the feudal European states, in order to stop Egypt to walk a normal walk as Britain have to walk a normal walk. So this is very important. After the defeat of Muhammad Ali, his son was inaugurated, but the embryo of the change is still inside the country. Britain also understood one thing. Britain also was watching on Europe. Once Muhammad Ali was removed by 1840-41, that it is a new element in Europe was developing. One is that it is the French Revolution have injected, according to them, a virus, and that virus which they call nationalism. There is a nationalist sentiment is growing in the southern Italy with the idea of Garibaldi and so on. And finally, Garibaldi, which is the southern Italy, was under the feudal ruler of Spain. That it is Garibaldi. Nationalism also is a peasant question. It is to liberate the peasantry and ally. It is an alliance between the bourgeoisie, the petty bourgeoisie, and the peasantry to create a nation state. What happened is that it is in Italy, already by 1963, Italian nation was built, southern Italy, the Italian nationalists came from southern Italy, defeated the Vatican, which had a very big area, and reduced Vatican to what it is now, a very small piece of hectare in Rome, and also defeated the Austrians, who have dominated the northern part of Italy, Milano, and so on, the industrialized area, and they created geographically Italy by 1863. This sentiment also was going in Germany. Germany, it was almost 900 feudal states. The biggest one is Borussia. And in Germany, there was a sentiment that it is German unity must come. And one of the most important thinkers of German unity is an economist who have wrote against Adam Smith. When Adam Smith established his work, which is called the Wealth of Nations, Friedrich List, who later on committed suicide and died, and he became even an advisor for the first American after the United States became independent. He became the architect of American economy, United States, and later on, because of his love for Germany, he came back and he committed suicide in 1848. He couldn't realize. It is a wonderful book. One has to read it in conjunction with what Adam Smith says. And Friedrich List says, Adam Smith is a liar, is a politician. Adam Smith, he says that it is the market, the invisible hand of the market will give to everybody a chance to compete. Friedrich List, he said, no, you are a liar. Imagine now, I translate it. If a 3-year-old kid runs a marathon with Haile Gebrselassie from Ethiopia, it is very obvious that it is Haile Gebrselassie will beat that 3-year-old 100 times. He says, you are lying. It is true in the maximum aspect. He said, you can, internationally you can open, first when you become strong at home. You organize yourself, you build a national economy, you transform the agriculture, you become strong. When you are strong, then you say, come, we will go to the ring and we will see the invisible hand of Adam Smith. That is Friedrich List's idea. And that is what Britain understood. Britain is reading at that moment, is a very big power. What Muhammad Ali is doing is what Friedrich List wants for Germany. And he was stopped. The defeat of Muhammad Ali and the experience of Muhammad Ali brought a new idea in the British Empire. We have to do something, they said. Egypt, it will again repeat, and it may buy new shoes, and it can walk, and if it starts walking, it will pass us very quickly. And if it passes us quickly, we will lose India, we will lose everything. We are a very small island, by accident of history, we are now important in the world. Neither because we have a very big civilization, we never invented Christianity, we have no civilization as the Chinese of 7,000 years, we have no civilization of the Indians, we have only one logic. And that logic is capitalism and industrialization. If this is repeated somewhere else, they will gang up on us. Therefore, we have to guard the city. And how you will guard them to stop Egypt? What you will do with that? They looked around in their experience. One of their important experiences was their experience in Australia. The British ruling class, after it put the vagabond law, any poor British man and woman, kid, anybody, who is accused by so-called police or whatever, police came later on after the working class organized, they just take you and deport you to Australia. But there, criminals who have taken so-called criminals, but in fact, what I call them, ordinary people, and they were afraid that the aristocracy and the British bourgeoisie, the number of the poor people in the street was increasing, children were roaming around without shoes and poverty is too much, and this will bring danger, and especially some of them who are a little bit, Marx, he says, in one of his he said, theft, stealing, is the beginning of consciousness. Because when you steal something, you break a law. It's the beginning of consciousness. It is destructive, but you are no more afraid when you steal. So if you continue in this process, you might bring also another type of organization. They dropped them, a lot of them, particularly men. All of them perished. Suddenly, a young aristocrat, a far-sighted man, he says, no, we are making really a mistake. If we send men, we have also to send women with them. And they ask him, why? If there is man and women, they go, and a lot of women we send with the men, they will marry, they will have a family there, they will have private property, as Engels, the origin of family and private property, as he writes it there. He says, once they are there, they have property, kill the indigenous people, take the land, they build a family, they have children, they are going to remain there. And they will defend that. And they will always be dependent on us. Already in Great Britain, from Luther time, a lot of Protestant ideas developing, which call Christian Zionism. Zionism as an ideology, it is not a creation of Jewish. It is a Christian creation. It took 400 years until it influences the Jews. So the idea, this young man, he says, his experience in Australia, which he succeeded by settling white settlers in Australia, eliminating the Aborigines, and they have dominated there. That experience can be, we can duplicate it in Palestine for several reasons. To cut Egypt from Asia, to put a settler state. Of course, most of the Jews, they were not supporters of Zionism. Even when Herzl, in his conference in Basel, in 1897, when he made a conference there not more than 60 Jews came. Majority of the Jews, they said, this is a stupid idea, and we are Europeans, and we are not interested about this. And in fact, because he was a journalist, Hungarian origin, and so on, he was affected with anti-Semitism in France, with Dafur, the officer who has been arrested and considered that a spy of Germany, then so and so on, and anti-Semitism was increasing because the process of imperialism also was becoming strong. They said, let's move the Jews, create a Zionist movement for them, and so on, move the poor one, because they are also troublemakers in Eastern Europe, and so on. A lot of them are city people. They have some revolutionary ideas, and so on, and so on, and so on. We collect them and put them in Palestine. So the project was to stop Egypt. If next time Egypt starts walking, then it has to exhaust her energy first with this Palestinian Zionist new settlers situation. It came from that point of view. I want you to see that. Because it is, they have planned for Egypt a lot of things. Once Muhammad Ali was defeated, the embryo of the idea that could not defeat, his son Caliph Ismail took over, and enlightenment came, exposure to the world became bigger, the French Revolution idea was developed. A lot of intellectuals came, like Afghani and so on, Egyptians and 20s, and they started bringing the idea of enlightenment. This idea of enlightenment, and a lot of debate is happening. We need a majlis, a constitution. There must be a constitutional work in this country. There must be a parliament. We must have a sovereign state and so on. Because the British, they are steering the thing behind the screen, and they cannot dominate directly Egypt. They know that if directly they do that, there will be a revolt. Egypt is a very, very, very conscious people. So they have to envisage the indirect rule. Britain is very sophisticated in a such system. So they are the Khedive, and they call it, even Sudan, they call it Egyptian Sudanese colonialism. They use the Egyptian troops, but it is the real benefit was going to Britain. Once Muhammad Ali was defeated, Khedive Ismail came. Britain used Egyptian agriculture for cotton production, using the Egyptian kulak. In Egypt, the landlords were encouraged to produce cotton. In one side, cotton production, very important. On the other side, that it is Britain gradually was dominating the French company, which envisaged to build the Suez Canal, which is later on defeated and became British capital became dominant. And the Suez Canal project was in the process. Third, Britain understood the canal would be finished in order to stop Muhammad Ali. But after that, by 1838-39, it also took over Aden, southern Yemen, and by 1840, it took over Bahrain, encircling, that it is encircling Germany, a future competitor, encircling France, and encircling Egypt. Egypt also, despite Muhammad Ali's absence, still Britain was not satisfied, and it is afraid. Suddenly, while in Egypt, that it is, the new idea was getting, incubating gradually, and there is a lot of discussion was going on. At that moment, the official language in Egypt remained Turkish. Egypt is an Arabic-speaking country. The first demand was to Arabize Egypt and to use Arabic as the official language. By 1860, Arabic became official language, which means that the majority of Egyptians now they are going to be involved in their country's affair. And the level, the intellectual level of the Egyptian people from different strata and so on, now could read in their own language, and the old Ottoman and Turkish language was abandoned. That is the first major Egypt did. The second Egypt, as I have told you, it is producing cotton. Suddenly, United States, with her own mistakes, United States got independent, and then the American Civil War started. The American Civil War between the Northern and the South, it is two different types of economic system. The South is slavery, and the North is a new energetic industrial bourgeoisie. Finally, the South asked or seceded from the North unilaterally. The American Civil War started. The American Civil War, I will not go deep over that, maybe next time in another lessons. The American Civil War stopped the production or the export of cotton. American cotton could not come to Great Britain. If Egypt cotton didn't succeed, and Egypt was the main provider for the British textile industry, Britain could have been in a very big problem. Probably we could have spoken differently what could happen to Britain. So Egypt, on the back of Egypt, that British textile industry, and textile industry means all other industries have been saved. Finally, with these discussions going on in the Egyptian parliament, they are asking Egyptian majlis And this parliament, it is not in the way we understand it now, that it is, it have to be nominated, the notables, the intellectuals, and so on. There was a reform in education, and so on. And the British sensed, and they start smelling bad things, that another Muhammad Ali situation could develop. And Britain was working behind. Already the Suez Canal was finished by 1868. And British troops, they are already there. And Suez Canal is, having Suez Canal in your hand, you can choke everybody in the world. Britain at that moment, it was the biggest power. It is, London is the center of capital. Her money is as equal as gold. Anybody who wants to make business must make insurance company, Lloyd Insurance Company. You have to be insured with London, otherwise pirates will take it from you. British Navy was dominating everything, the seas and ocean in the world. So Britain wants to dominate and to keep also India, the Java. And wants to continue the indirect colonialism in Egypt. And from that, the different classes in Egypt were organizing, including the Enlightenment, including the intelligentsia, including the embryo bourgeoisie which have developed, and so on and so on. Urabi, Zaqloul, Tala'at Har, all these people unified for independence Egypt and to have an independent parliament. They have now the language is Arabic, the economy to a certain extent. Their slogan was, most of the people who work behind the administration in the Caliph Ismail, they were foreigners, non-Egyptians. They were using foreign language, French, English, Italians, German, Swedish, and so on, immigrants who have come there. So the demand was Egypt for Egyptians. As a result of that, Great Britain was obliged now. She used to control the things behind the curtain. Now the danger in front of her, by 1882, she was obliged officially to colonize Egypt. Egypt officially became a colony in 1882. In between, there was a revolt. And with that revolt, a young man who was an officer of Muhammad Ali's troops, and a patriotic and nationalist man who have allied with a lot of Egyptian nationalists, he organized a secret organization to assassinate British officers and those behind the screen. His name is Ahmed Urabi, which is called the Urabi Revolution. And all this frightened Egypt. After the Urabi revolt was defeated, Egypt became official colony of Britain. I will take out this and report. From 1882, official colony of Egypt, until 1919, a new thing developed in Egypt again. Embryo of industrialization developed. Alexandria became a Western city. A lot of Westerns came in hotel industry and tourism, including Eric Hobsbawm was born in Alexandria. Alexandria and Cairo, to a certain extent, had best British and French schools. Some of the bourgeoisie, like the family of Eric Hobsbawm and others, came to work in Egypt, and they needed a very good schools. Alexandria, like Istanbul, had a very good French schools and a very good lycée, in French and English school, one of the oldest lycées in the world outside France is in Istanbul and in Alexandria, including the Faculty of Medicine. It is the oldest one. Gradually, Cairo also became bigger. Hotel industry developed, modernization developed, certain industries developed. The bourgeoisie in Egypt was demanding national bank. One of the major slogans of the bourgeoisie in independence is one, independence and national sovereignty. When we say national sovereignty means this nation belongs to me and this market belongs to me. Second, a flag. A flag, this flag, this territory belongs to me and I represent behind the flag this nation. It's important, like the French flag. It came only after the French Revolution. Third, you need to have a central bank. Central bank is the nerve of the economy, whereby the central bank, which also produces the monetary, the money, it prints money. A nation doesn't have central bank, have no independence in her economy. It's very, very important. Zaghloul, Urabi, and all the others are demanding Masr lil-Masriyin, Egypt for Egypt. We wanted to have a national parliament. We want to have a national economy. We want to have national bank. Because when you have national bank, you are sovereign. When you look in every currency, when you take the euro, and you see the signature in the paper of the euro, the one who signs is the European bank, which is in Germany, is a German, they call it European, but for me it's a German. German bank who signs, which means it is sovereign. Anybody who have this money can claim to that bank to pay him in gold. That is a sovereignty. And they were demanding this. In the process in Egypt also, why they are demanding? The local industrialists, not those who are attached to the British imperialists, the Europeans who came, who created shoe industry, Armenians, Greek, and so on and so on and so on. A big number of them, they were the pancreas of British imperialism. I call them the pancreas class. They are not connected. They are, in fact, the only create for that nation, diabetic. And if you want to be healthy and not to have diabetic, you have to remove that pancreas class. And that pancreas class must be established by national patriotic class. And to do that, you need to have national bank. Egypt have national army, which is Muhammad Ali created, Urabi and all this. National army without national bank have no meaning. First World War broke. When First World War broke, while in Egypt industrialization and local industrialism was developing, the same year, Great Britain, because of the war, it had put in her energy too much fighting against German imperialism. It had to relax her domination in Egypt. As a result of that, the local bourgeoisie, the industrialist bourgeoisie in India and Egypt grew. It benefited from the contradiction of the war. So there is no way now to stop Egypt. The pancreas is dying. The pancreas is selling baklava and hotel and all this. The others are moving from other industry to other industries. Gradually, they are moving also into a chemical industry and pharmaceutical industry. That's why Mao Zedong says the comprador bourgeoisie. He calls it comprador bourgeoisie. I call them foreign pancreas bourgeoisie. When you cut them, the pancreas, when you remove them, the liver functions good. Anyway, Egypt and India almost semi-industrialized this to a certain extent. One of the demands of Zaghloul is one of the patriotic businessman, nationalist Egyptian, a very wise man. He demanded that Egyptian national bank, Al-Bank Al-Masri, Egyptian bank. When you have an Egyptian bank, you can also teach the peasantry to deposit their money there. You can also give loan to the industrialists who are in the embryo level and so on, to be encouraged and so on and develop their industry. Which is means you also kill the false competitor who have access through the back door and bring in goods. Mind you, by that moment already Egypt is a semi-colony. More than 100,000 Egyptian troops are there. It is Lord Connor, the British colonial administrator. He was right in one of his meetings. He was making a discussion with the officers in the time of Urabi revolt and revolution. He collected all British officers and invited them for a reception, and he made a speech. He said, "Open your window." Everybody opened the window. So what did you see outside? Most of them, we see only Mustafa. You know what is Mustafa? Mustafa is a term to the Arab, means he's a Negro. Mustafa, ya Mustafa. There was even a song in French and so on. For every Arab, they call them Mustafa. A Negro means another one. British officers, they said, "We only see Mustafa with jalabiya, with the Egyptian clothes." And they were sipping their whiskey, Scottish whiskey. He got angry. Said, "You only see Mustafa? You cannot see beyond Mustafa? You don't see that Mustafa and the dress he wears, the jalabiya, behind the jalabiya, what a civilization is there? And because of the Fallah's turban, behind that turban there is brain, history," he says. "Look to the pyramid. We have to do something to this country. Sooner or later they will kick us from this place." That is normal, he said. Nobody likes to be dominated. "But my worriness," he said, "they will kick us, they will reach us, and they will pass us. Because we have no civilization, but these people have 4,000 years civilization. Look to the pyramids." He was right. A very far-sighted man. He said, "What we have to do then to stop these people? We must stop them, we must guard them." Nobody could even give him an answer. Then he said, "I have an answer for that. Deform their educational system. Qira'atul fiqh. Instead, democratic education to be developed in Egypt, which means an education based on a democratic discussion between the teacher and the student. At the end of the lesson, you will come to a result, qualitative development. But if you are a teacher, as a priest, you are reading to the small priests, and there is no any discussion among the peoples, then there is no civilization. They will only memorize, and then they will only answer to you in the exams, but they don't internalize," he said. "We have to omit Egyptians internalize. If they internalize, they will internalize science. They have a brain, they have a culture, they have civilized the people. They don't have clans, they don't have tribes. They will pass us," he said. "Let us deform their educational system." Which is means, let us encourage reactionary type of educational pedagogy, using the mullahs, using and this and this, and bring them back to old ages. Muhammad Ali reformed the Al-Azhar University. Muhammad Ali reformed the educational system. So what he wants these colonialists, he said, "If we leave, we have to destroy the educational system. They will throw us, but they should not catch up with us." Unfortunately for him, he was forced. By 1922, Egypt became from colony to semi-colony. Why I say semi-colony? More than 100,000 British troops were occupying the Suez Canal. The third important point is, now we speak the textile, the society of Egypt. Who is who in Egypt? Egypt officially became independent. But British troops are occupying the most important organ of Egyptian body, which is the Suez Canal, which brings a lot of money for the British imperialists. In Egypt, in 1922, until 1952, 80% of the land, the farming land, is owned by 2,000 families. The remaining 20,000 or 20% is owned by 20,000 families. So in a real sense, the real Egyptians who owned in that land, they are not more than 25,000. There is a lot of also foreign origin Egyptians. This is the social class in Egypt. In 1920s in Egypt, two parties emerged. In one side, immigrant Europeans, particularly from Armenia after the genocide in Armenia, Greece, Malta, and some French from southern France, and some Jews who had run away because by 1920, the first danger for Europe came Mussolini, the editor of Avanti, became a fascist, incubated and bought by Banco di Roma, and took over, fascists took over in Italy. Europe was going, after the inter-imperialist First World War, the danger in Europe again for fascism and Nazism and the coming war was becoming clearer and clearer. A lot of progressive elements, they start running from their countries. They came to Egypt, they stayed in Algeria, Alexandria, which is a modern city, Mediterranean city, Cairo and so on. And from this one, from this immigrant, the first Communist Party of Egypt was created. Three Communist Parties in the African continent and in the Arab world came in relation to what has happened to Europe. In Europe in 1920, the Communist Parties became official. The Communist Party of South Africa, they were European Jews who ran away, went to South Africa, and in South Africa, they built the South African Communist Party, and that South African Communist Party was a white Communist Party. In fact, they were demanding the same wage as other whites. The second is the Palestinian Communist Party. The Palestinian Communist Party, which also came at that time, whereby a lot of Jews, European Jews, who went to so-called Israel now, but at that time Palestine, and some of the communists organized with some Palestinian Arabs, and they created the Palestinian Communist Party, with all their own contradictions and so on, I'm not going in details. The third is in the Egyptian Communist Party. At one time, in one of international conference, somebody advised them, from where you are, Communist Party of South Africa, but you are only white, I don't see black, so you have to create blackenized, and they accepted, and now the South African Communist Party is almost exclusively is a black Communist Party. For the Palestinian Communist Party, he told them, I don't see the Arabs there. A comrade, a brilliant comrade at that moment, and he said, Arabize. They refused to Arabize. They tried some of them, but basically they refused. If the majority of the population is Arab, and you wanted to organize them, and you wanted to build a new society, then you have to Arabize your party. How you are going to communicate with the people? You wanted to organize them. The Egyptian Communist Party also Arabized to that extent. The second Communist Party is that later on became party. It is the Muslim Brotherhood. The Muslim Brotherhood, most of them are member of the teachers, came from the Kulak class, particularly from, I told you, the 20,000 Kulak of landlord classes. Hassan al-Banna is the founder of it. Of course, they use history, Islam, and so on, but it is modern. It is not like the Sheikh organization of the past. It is a party whose contribution, it has its journal, it has its influence, and so on. These two parties existed. Third political party emerged with Zaqlul and other, the Wafd party, which is the liberal nationalist party, also came, which have a very strong basis in Egypt. So Egypt was transformed now to the second position, where political parties, on their ideologies, they write, they agitate, and so on. Until 1952. By 1952, the three political parties could not have the real effect of changing Egypt. Finally, the officers took over the power, the free officers. The free officers, they were influenced by all the three organizations. Nasser once was influenced by the Muslim Brotherhood, later on by the Communist and Arab Patriotic Forces, and so on. When the officers took over, there was also one civilian who is the ideologue, Sheikh Qutb, in these meetings. And he was one of the leadership of the there. He is a civilian. This popular revolt, popular democracy, national sovereignty, building Egypt from inside, not from outside. How you will build Egypt from inside if you don't make land reform? One. How you will bring Egypt modern if you cannot electrify and create electricity to the whole population, to the rural areas and to the cities and to the industries? Which is means Egypt must produce electricity. And to produce electricity with the studies it made, they have to create a dam. The Aswan Dam, which later on was created. According to the World Bank, the 20th century, the only huge and important construction happened in human history is the construction of Aswan Dam. Once Aswan Dam was constructed, that Egypt have solved her electricity problem. Electrification, it entered to every village, which is means the difference between a day and night was broken. You can produce, as they call it here, the three plug, 24 hours in your factory. There is no barrier between night and day. Science, electricity, we are looked. There is no difference. Electrification, land reform, national education, national independence. Now the Muslim Brotherhood says, here it comes the contradiction with the Muslim Brotherhood. The Muslim Brotherhood, from its inception until today, it is, they say, property is holy. Property is God-given. Al-Milkiya Muqaddas. Which is means you cannot make land reform. It's impossible. They say it is no. The state must help the poor through, as here they do, with Salvation Front and soup in the street, whatever it is. But you cannot touch the property. It is holy. The first contradiction comes there. National independence, you can only realize that Egypt, when it feeds itself, a nation can only be independent when it, as Muhammad Ali says, we will eat from what we produced, and we will dress from what we have produced our factory. Na'kul, we will eat from our agriculture. and we will wear from our textile industry. When somebody is free, you could call, when he dresses from its own textile industry and eats from its own agriculture, which is means Egypt must be independent in producing its own food. And to be independent, you have to create a land reform. And when you create land reform, you bring science, knowledge to the families and the children of the peasantry who have been in the past, in bracket, mahrumin, who have been never given a chance. Egyptian villages, the Egyptian fallah, farmer, will be acquainted with science, and he will also produce more cattle breeding, and so on and so on. That Egypt will be suffering. Nobody will come and put finger on her. A nation who doesn't determine its own economy and its food and so on, it is not independent nation. It is a false flag. This contradiction brought a serious conflict between the Muslim Brotherhood and the popular revolution led by the officers. And finally, they were jailed, and they left. Some of them went outside of the country. Egypt under Nasser, now we come, I told you, Egypt, it is like an X-ray. Egypt, like you put somebody and you check his liver, his lung, and so on, and put a photo in all of this. Egypt is the machine of the Arab photo. Change in Egypt means it will spark change in the Arab world. And that change in the Arab world means a change in the African continent and Asia. And it is true. Egypt built a modern industry. Egypt became the Mecca of African revolutionaries. Pierre Mulele, the Congolese, he was living in Egypt. Kwame Nkrumah, the father of Pan-Africanism, he was also living in Egypt. Not only that, he married an Egyptian woman. He has a son called Jamal Nkrumah, who works in Egyptian Gazette, Egyptian Haram. All Africans who are willing wants independence for Africa. Cairo became the Mecca of revolutionaries. For the Arabs, for the third world people, and for Africa. So the radius of Cairo, it is bigger than Egypt, as I have told you in the beginning. As a result of the charisma of the Egyptian revolution, the non-aligned movement with alliance of Soekarno of Indonesia in Bandung signed. Imperialism is a retreat, these cowards. They were in retreat. And Africa in the verge of independence. 56, Kwame Nkrumah, Ghana, and Africa is getting independence. The alliance between the communist countries, the socialist countries, the revolution in Cuba of 1959, all these have tilted the balance of imperialism. Imperialism was a retreat. All the imperialist forces, with all small, all of them, they were under the eagle hand through Nasser. Nasser must be removed. Egyptian revolution must be aborted from within or from outside. In Yemen, as a result of that, the Republican Revolution came in Yemen. In Saudi Arabia, the Saudi officers refused to bomb Yemen and defected with their plane. The Saudi ruling class split it into two. Almost a coup d'etat happened in Saudi Arabia. The feudal ruling class who are ruling there, they were in panic. As a result of that also, the change in Syria came. What option they have?
The only option they have, the propaganda against Nasser, that he wants to put all the Jews in the sea, the Hitler of the Arabs. The balance of forces changed again, 1969, before he died, the overthrow of the feudal backward regime of Libya and Muammar Gaddafi coming to power. The Ba'athist in Iraq took over. Imperialism was choking. There was a serious retreat. 1967, Yemen war, which Egyptian soldiers have participated there, and 1967, attack of Israel against Egypt to demoralize Egyptian revolution. The decline started from 1967. Even though, even 1967 Israel defeated, Egypt was economically very, very strong. By 1970, the economic condition of Egypt in industry and so on is as equal as Italy. In military industry, in chemical industry, in pharmaceutical industry, agriculture, Egypt was producing 85% of food from inside. A magnificent development. When I was in Egypt, 22,000 Africans and third world students were studying in Egyptian universities free by Egyptian scholarship. So the world was changed. Algeria got independent. The defeat of the French settler colonialism. This frightened imperialism. And I advise you to read the book of Holocaust industry of the American, I forgot his name, Finkelstein. He says the importance of Israel came after 1967 war. Nasser passed away as a young man. But before that, I tell you one anecdote. In this book, Muhammad al-Haykal. Muhammad al-Haykal is the editor-in-chief of the Al-Ahram. And he was the right hand of Nasser. And the title, he was invited after the Iranian Revolution, 1979, and he was invited in Iran, and they opened for him all the archive to read the archive of the Shah. Because I have to tell you a little bit that. And as a result of that, he writes this book, Sacred Channel. In order to stop the Egyptian revolution and the Ba'athist revolution in Syria and Iraq, imperialism at the same time is going into the general economic crisis. It has to create a new strategy. If it is possible to infiltrate Egypt and try to make a coup, which they didn't succeed, in the United States, they have four establishments. The first is, when a country comes a change and a new ruling class or a new group come in power, the first group they will be sent, best economists who have been studied in American universities, and the best student and the brightest one, they will be recruited. And they put them in an office. They call them the economic hitman. They go to that country, they study everything, and they come. Before they send anything, they send you the economic hitman. The economic hitman studies that country, he studies the difficulties that country have and everything, and comes with a project. We will borrow you money to build that said dam. They will meet the decision makers. And he will put the project, and he will say, we will borrow you money, we can build for you this dam. But in the project itself, at the end, when you break down the mathematically, what goes to the project, they put what they call about 20%, 23% or something, unforeseen item. Unforeseen item means bribe. The moment you sign that, the economic hitman is succeeded. He will call to the headquarters, they say the fish is in the harbor. He's no more dangerous. If they didn't succeed on that, then they will send the jackal, the killers, snipers. Nasser, 192 times they tried to kill him. Saddam, 272 times they tried to kill him. Hafiz al-Assad, let's say, the jackals, they will say, shoot him. The snipers must come, from within or outside. But if you are strong, and you have a strong intelligence service, you have a very strong defense mechanism, like a virus, a very good antivirus, it's not able. That chapter is closed. The jackals cannot do anything. Then what they will do? Pentagon will come to you. Then they will invade you. That is last option. In this book, Haykal speaks. Haykal goes and he concludes, he goes to the United States in 1954. Einstein knew Haykal is coming. Albert Einstein, the scientist. He contacts the State Department and he says, I would really like to meet Muhammad al-Haykal. He's a reasonable man and I want to discuss with him. Finally, he makes contact the Egyptian embassy and he says that I'm Einstein, and it's known Einstein, the brilliant man. He said, I would really like to meet Haykal. And Haykal, when he was told, he contacted him, he invited Haykal in his residence. And in this book he says, Einstein, you have taken over Egypt. I have only three questions. I know the Zionists who have taken over Palestine. They have no head. These are a bunch of crazy people. You know that Einstein was once proposed to be a president of Israel. And he rejected it after he advised the Zionists. When they rejected his project. He says, one Palestine. We have to live with the Arabs. You have to live with the Arabs. He says, I know. On the other side, there is crazy people of the Middle Ages, full of Torah in their head. But you have taken over now Egypt. And Egypt is a highly civilized country. What you are planning for the Jews? He asked. Further discussion. You cannot and buy this book and read it. It is an intelligent book, very nicely written. Anyway, in this book, other thing he says, what he discovered from the Iranian archive is the creation of the Safari Party, the Safari Club. After Nasser died, Sadat took over Egypt, and then he sold out Egypt. Systematically, he destroyed Egypt from inside. Land reform was destroyed, and now Egypt 100% buy her grain from international market. And the time of Abdel Nasser, 85% of the food was produced. Land reform was taken from the peasant, was given to their owners. Third, in the name of infitah, openness, the so-called liberal openness. In our television here, when they speak, there is an openness. Openness means we can still have been warned. Openness means we can go in into somebody's pocket and we steal. And they call it democracy. Allah, what a democracy. Openness. Vrehet, like to steal, to make people poor. Structural adjustment, Sadat, two things he did, 1,400 and something Egyptian industries destroyed and sold and closed. In the name of openness, goods, all these rubbish goods produced outside by Egyptian hard currency enter into the country. 100 type of soaps, looks, lavashkri, all these have been dumped there. The subsidies which is supposed to be given to the peasantry was stopped. Egypt was going to the dark ages, in all sense of it. Not only that, destroying the Egyptian constitution. Egyptian constitution says, Al-Balad al-Jami' al-Din lillah, the country for everybody and God for Allah. But country is for everybody. He start showing himself in the television, that the television news must start with Quran, which is against the constitution. Now when you fly with Egyptian Airways, they even put for you Quran, that the plane not to crash. Islamization. Those who have been in prison, the Muslim Brotherhood, they were released. And those who had been outside, supported by the Wahhabists, they came. Why he does that? To destroy Nasserist, communist, secular Arabist movement. In the student movement, in the trade union, and so on and so on. They became the fifth column and destroying and fighting any progressive ideas. When I was a student in Egypt, except old ladies, most of the students and most of young women who work and who study, I have never seen that they were wearing hijab. Today they are wearing burqas. Bringing them back. The participation of Egyptian women who have acquired, struggled in the army, in the economy, in the education and so on, was dashed away slowly. Except for the comprador bourgeoisie children and so on. Privatization of education. The peasants start leaving because leaving their areas, they learn nobody supports them and so on. Today in Egypt, there is 6 million drug addicted children of peasants who live in Cairo, which is later on, they use them in Tahrir in order to attack women, to attack and so on and so on. These are children of the peasant. The policy of Sadat continued. What he didn't understand is that there was a debate in Egypt inside the prison between the Islamists. The younger generation and the older generation Islamist conflict happened with them. You know, you can arrest somebody physically, but you cannot arrest his brain. Prison is the best place to study if you survive it. And there was a debate in prison between the young one led by Ayman al-Zawahiri, Dr. Ayman al-Zawahiri. Dr. Ayman al-Zawahiri came from a prominent bourgeois Egyptian. His families had been advisors for the Islamic State for 800 years. His uncle, in one side, is the founder of the Arab League. Another uncle of him, he's a founder of Cairo University, one of the biggest universities. Highly intellectual family. All of them are in the sector of the medical school. Another uncle of him, he is the dean, the founder of Faculty of Medicine of University of Cairo. 100 years ago. He is not just a mullah with turban. He is a bourgeois with another vision. Then he said, you elderly people, you put us to abattoir. You don't know what is an state means. A state have a repression organ. It have an army. It have a security. It have a bureaucracy. It issues money. You just brought all of us in prison. And then he developed a theory called the far enemy and the near enemy. The far enemy is imperialism for him. The near enemy is the puppet regime. He says, anyway, they are the same and twin. If you fight the near enemy, the far enemy will come when the near enemy becomes weak. And then later on became the founder of Al-Qaeda with Osama bin Laden. We will discuss about another time this. Egypt, under Sadat al-Mubarak, became an absolute dependent. Example I give you, 50% of Egyptian budget was allocated only for Cairo. Today, 4 to 5 provinces in Egypt, if they eat one time a day, they are lucky. How Egypt was and what is today. In order to know what is the popular revolt and what is waiting Egypt. The internal enemy is the worst enemy than external enemy. The external enemy, you can see it, but the internal enemy is a chameleon. It will be from within. And it destroys you and kills you slowly, like cancer. Unless you eliminate them, even chemo will not help you. Systematically, they destroyed that country. The destruction, the weakening of Egypt and so on, it destroyed all of us. From the Horn of Africa, the whole continent of Africa, the whole Arab world, and the whole third world. I have said in the beginning, Egypt is an important country. The destruction of Egypt is the result of the Somali civil war. The destruction of Egypt is the invasion of the war in Yemen. The destruction of Egypt is the attack of Iraq. No way if Egypt had survived 1990 or Iraq, imperialism could not have invaded Iraq. Egypt is muqaddas for us. Egypt is holy for the people of the third world in Africa and the Arab world. All the others are rubbish. The small ones from Morocco to except Algeria and so on, they are insignificant. They are only geographies. Egypt is a motor. If Egypt of Nasser existed, Turkish-Greek conflict in Cyprus will not happen. Because Egypt's policy on the Mediterranean was very, very important. It checked Turkish NATO imperialist vision. Because Turkey, Iran of Shah, and my country Ethiopia, what Chomsky calls the triangle, the three triangle of imperialism, with Israel, they were the one who are fighting against progressive Arab and particularly Egypt. In 1953, after Nasser took over the power, Ben Gurion, in this book says, Ben-Gurion speaks to three countries. He says, I wanted to know the idea of this young man. To the Romanians, to the Yugoslav, and to another country. It is in the book. He says, go to this young man and ask him what he is thinking about Israel. They went to him. He was there, he was present. He said, they ask us. Nasser, what do you think about Israel? He says, I don't think anything about Israel. I'm busy with Egypt. Again, they met him to confirm. He says, my friend, you are always asking me about Israel, but I'm busy about Egypt. And again, 4 times they met him. So finally, they went to Ben-Gurion. Ben-Gurion received them, gives them drink and so on. And he says, hold on. First, I want the bad news. Oh, Excellency, they say, there is no bad news. Why? Tell me. We ask him 4 times, the young man, what he is thinking about Israel. He said, he is busy with Egypt. He doesn't think about Israel. Then Ben-Gurion answers, this is a very bad news. The worst news. Now, from now on, I will not sleep. He is making Egypt strong from inside. When you are strong from inside, an external enemy, whatever it is, armada it have, and the people is with you, is irrelevant, is a paper tiger, as Mao Zedong says. I went to Egypt to conclude, in a country which I studied, I loved the Egyptian people, under the legacy of Nasser, in 2008. I was walking in Adolf Marx with a friend of mine. Suddenly, I looked up, there is Egyptian Airways office. Then I said, come, let's go and check. So we went in, And then I asked her, I was joking, I didn't plan anything. It was an spontaneous. But still, I had a memory for Egypt. I was in the student movement in Egypt and so on. It is like my second country. So I asked the Belgian lady there, I said, tell me, it was beginning of December, how much is it to go to Cairo to go and to come back? She said, 321. I just book for me. After tomorrow, I will go. And I bought the ticket. I went to the airport in Zaventem. I was thinking, I said, now you are going to Egypt. And you read a lot about Egypt, that a lot of people are in prison. And Egypt is not the same as before. Muhammad, take care of your tongue. One, discipline yourself. Second, if you listen, don't remember. Because I was frightened. What I read there, how many Egyptians are in prison, and so on. Then I go there and I end up in prison in Egyptian torture. You will never see me again. I came to the airport. Friedrich Ebert, a German organization. Friedrich Ebert is a prime minister of Germany who killed the best revolutionaries like Rosa Luxemburg and others in 1918. A social democrat, a reactionary social democrat in the German Revolution. Brought Egyptian journalists to train them, to show them democracy. They show you the democracy, the building European parliaments or little building. Finally, it ends up with a grand palace and cake and so on. There is a place, big beer they give you. There is a horse also inside and so on. And then you become, they give you a diploma that you understand democracy. They pumped, all of them are from so-called free journalists. I was sitting in the plane, and there is a Belgian guy sitting in front, and then and also another Egyptian guy. While they are talking, the Egyptian guy dragged me a little bit. They speak very nice Egyptians. Then I said, what you are doing? He said, I'm a journalist. I said, oh, journalist, which journal? He said, Rosal Yusuf. Rosal Yusuf was a journal of the communist in the time. I was impressed. I said, I got my friend who's going to tell me something. I said, Rosal Yusuf, the one I know? He said, no, no, no. We bought it and we used the name. Then I said, how is Egypt? Well, we are talking so on. He said, Egypt is democratic and this. Then something slipped from my tongue. I said, but I hear a lot of people arrested and so on. So he shouted, you know, but the plane was flying to Egypt. I said, I created a problem. I didn't want to discuss about this matter. I was really frightened. He called the other journalist, Ya Jama'a, he called them and said, tell him, this Ethiopian, that how Egypt is developing and Egypt is democratic and so on. And the other one, he gave me lecture and so on. I said, oh, I didn't know. So this Western journalist, I have to hide myself because I don't know who is he. This Western journalist, they are lying to us. Huh? I have never been in Egypt for 29 years, which is true. I kept quiet. We reached to Cairo. What surprised me? I left Cairo. The airport of Cairo was outside of the city. Now the airport has become the center of the city. The airport, when I left Cairo, 1979, the airport, when you want to go to airport, the airport is more than 20, 30 kilometers far away of the city. You need to have a taxi. Then we were flying. The center, the airport became a center. Building without any planning. You know, this building industry is the best way of making corruption. And it is the mother of corruption is in building industry if you can't control it. They just build and there is no control whether there is enough cement and so on. So we arrived in Cairo and then he said, the man, he gave me his card. I said, I better go. First to the Somali student association. I was active there, and we have an office there in cultural center, 36 Sharif Pasha. So I asked the taxi man, and he brought me there. There was a young man, he died, not young man, he became old. He and his father, they are Egyptians, were working for us there, providing us tea. And when we were students, when we used to make meeting, we suspect them as Egyptian intelligence. So when I came, Muhammad, he passed away, he recognized me. He said, Ahlan wa sahlan, we greet each other and so on. He brought the tea for me and my bag is there. So I said, Muhammad. It was in front of me, the big picture of Mubarak. I said, A'tini ru'us al-aqlam. Give me short, without anything, the temperature here. He shouted. Al-balad yahkumha isab. The country is ruled by gangs. This bastard. I said, oh. I said, is it the word of the intelligence? He said, no, min qalbi. Oh, I said, this is a change. He took me to a hotel. I put my bag. There were some people who were sitting at the hotel there. They looked like me. I knew they are from southern Egypt, from Aswan. So when I came down, they said hello to me. How are you? Fine. Have a seat, tea. They thought I came from Aswan, from southern Egypt. I said, they gave me, I just wanted to take the temperature. So I said, how is it? And so, from where did you come? I said, 29 years ago, I was a student, I'm from there, and I came from Belgium and so on. This country is ruled by thieves. All of them, they start shouting. These bastards, they destroyed the country. I got frightened now. After 3 days, I was walking in the bus, I was taking a bus. The Iraqi journalist who threw the shoes on Bush, everybody was talking about him. To make the story short, it was Islamic holiday, offers fest. I come from the student office, and I go to Tahrir. There is a street called Shara Talat al-Harb. A lot of police, with uniform and without uniform. You see also those without uniform with their gun. And I saw a young man, handsome, tall, beautiful uniform, black uniform with white shirt and with a very good Italian thing, standing there. A lot of things he have around him. So I said, why I don't go ask him? And around him there were also other officers. I came to him and I said, do you speak English, sir? He said, yes, I studied in the United States. I said, oh. He asked me, from where you are? I have to think quick. I said, I'm from Ethiopia. Oh, you don't speak Arabic? I don't speak Arabic. I said, can you tell me, what is this? Very nice uniform. He said, I am a police general, brigadier general. Maybe he was about 42 years old. I laughed. I said, why do you laugh? I said, in my country, general, go by helicopter. Why you are walking now, all this? Listen, he said, wait. He called his officer, said, what do you drink? I said, tea. With what? With milk. Bring tea with milk for him. You will see something. Then he pointed to me, a lot of young people, girls and boys, coming from the metro, from Tahrir. It was holiday, and that area is a cinema area. He said, you see all those thousands of thousands? I said, yes. If one of them stands up and makes a speech of 2 minutes, it will turn into a popular revolt. And if you are surprised, you will see somebody is coming in. The Minister of Interior, with his motorbike police, he was checking everywhere. He said he will not sleep for 48 hours. Otherwise, he will lose the job. Then I said, the Egyptian people are not willing to live as before. And the ruling class is not able to rule as before. When these two mechanisms happen together, a revolt will come. I came here and I made an interview with Michel Collot. I said, there will be a popular revolt in Egypt. That was 2008. And a lot of people, they think it is. It's good what you are talking, Muhammad. It is your wish, but nothing will happen. After 2 years, popular revolt happened. Now, the popular revolt and which forces are there, and we stop. You can ask me a question. In this popular revolt, five forces, external forces, involved. One, to influence and dominate this popular revolt. Qatar decided longer time when she established the very good decision they made by creating Al Jazeera. They showed themselves as a progressive journalist. They win the mind of the heart of a lot of people in the world in the beginning. But Qatar had a vision of her own. Qatar have a serious contradiction with the Wahhabist Saudis. By creating Al Jazeera, it opened for two people, two prominent individuals, to discuss in Al Jazeera about the Arab world. One is Muhammad Al-Haykal, who had been a progressive journalist and so on. The other is a Muslim Brotherhood speaker and an ideologue. I forgot his name, I will tell you later. Qardawi, Allah yatawwal umrak, Al-Qardawi. Qatar was connected with the idea, together with Turkish Erdogan and with the imperialist forces, the Democrats and the conservative in the United States and the imperialist countries. They developed an idea before Qatar promoting this. They wanted to promote the project which they call it Islam liberalism, Islam Calvinism, with the experience that the British had built after the defeat of the communists in Malaysia, the Malaysian scenario. They put it out of the fridge. Malaysia is democratic, economically liberal, and so on and so on. So the Malaysian export must be implemented. And that was also implemented in Turkey, and Erdogan and others took over. Economically, they are very liberal. They call them the Islamo-Calvinists. Modern Calvinist, capitalist, who believe in the market and the globalization, and they are not the traditionalist and to fight, they can fight Al-Qaeda, the jihadist element, and they can also fight against Wahhabism. What a cocktail. A young Turkish man, a brilliant Turkish man. I don't read most of the time what the Westerns write, because they don't know. They better write about themselves than most of them. They are just a bunch of stupids. I'm sorry, I'm not arrogant, but I read a lot about them, and most of the what they tell me is that it is Alibaba and the 40 thieves. They themselves, somebody who have never traveled beyond Arizona, how he can write about Egypt. The fall of the Turkish model. Later on you can write it and read it. I know in our country people have come from the education of what the British colonialist in Egypt said, that we have to deform their educational system. Our school here, this is a school for us. We discuss about it. At least we are open, we can debate. And I consider it, this school is a progressive school against the school of mummerization. You can ask, you can debate, and so on. I learn from you and you learn from me. This is a democratic education. Not the education that they inculcate our children in their institution. Anyway, the Turkish model associated with Qatar, the fear of Wahhabism, this force influencing the Muslim Brotherhood, and a Muslim Brotherhood accepting the Turkish model economically. The second force is Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia backward, a lot of money, but supports exports, reactionary Wahhabist ideology, Salafist, which in Egypt, the Noor Party. the Muslim Brotherhood on one side, the Nuer Party. Egypt, in the time of Sadat and Mubarak, all patriotic progressive parties, they were banned. In this revolt, the Saudis on one side with Wahhabism, the Qataris and the Turkish and so on with Islamic Brotherhood, and the Israelis intelligence put small shoes in the Egyptian feet, like the Chinese before the revolution. Chinese, the women, they put on them small foot, because they like small foot, they used to break them, and they cannot walk, Chinese peasant. So the Israelis' strategy is put, Egyptian foot is very big, make sure that if it is 65 they wear for the shoes, give them 8. They cannot walk. So the infiltration of the Israeli intelligence and the fear what's happening in Egypt. The third. The fourth, NATO and the father of NATO. Change in Egypt means the beginning and the fastest rate of the decline of American hegemonism in the world. With the rising power of China, Russia, other countries, and capitalism have moved, and the biggest economy is today is in Asia. Egypt, if it will be included, and this popular revolution comes, popular revolution on the basis of popular thinking, then Egypt will delink. So Egypt must be stopped. Because it's not only Egypt, popular democracy will bring a dangerous situation to the feudal ruling class in Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and all this. All these forces, from the German intelligence, American intelligence, European and British intelligence, Turkish alliance, Qatari alliance, and the Salafists and so on, wanted to dominate this revolution and to reverse. Finally, United States tried to keep Mubarak. At the end, the Egyptian working class strike pushed them, and they wanted the intelligence serviceman Suleiman, which we never speak about him now. He was found, he was killed. No? I think he was killed by intelligence, other intelligence service, and so on. Finally, Mubarak and all these four, election happens. When it is the election happened, the most important is here, the thermometer, and I will stop, the thermometer of the Egyptian popular revolt. The forces of change and the forces of reaction competed in the Egyptian market. The forces of change, there were parties spontaneously came after the downfall of Mubarak. In the election, literally they had won the election. It's not the Muslim Brotherhood who won. The only difference is they couldn't make alliance. They are young parties and they could not make alliance because they didn't have the time to study and to know the class contradictions and the conflicts there. Those who are with the enemy and those who are with the friend. This is a very good signal for Egypt. Which is, means next election in Egypt will never, reactionary forces will win. That is an alarm for American imperialism and for imperialism and for the Zionists. Egyptian popular revolt with Egyptian popular election, it is a new chapter in the Arab world could happen. They said, what? Abortion. The Muslim Brotherhood, they won because not they have the highest vote, but the Muslim Brotherhood, they continued with their line of with Erdogan and all this, and the army took them out. Conclusion. New information. A new wells now discovered in Egypt. As I said, Egypt is not a normal country, now even become a special country. Egypt discovered a very big wells in both sides. One, a huge concentration of gas. Recently they discovered. Second, in 10 billion, they are enlarging the Suez Canal. Third, a huge reserve of water underground, like silt of Libya. The southern Egypt, this reserve of water, it starts from southern Egypt until Eritrea. The scientific studies proved immense of rivers inside the ground. Conclusion. Comrade Lenin said when he speaks about agriculture, imagine how far-sighted this man was. When he wrote about agriculture, he spoke about the Sahara. He said the Sahara can feed the whole humanity, provided the right technology is invented. And he said, I am sure, he said, humanity will invent that technology. It can dig in into the Sahara and will go deep and find the water sources. He was proved to this. Thank you. If you have other questions, I will answer. I don't hear you. Can you stand over here?
I have a question about the new ruling class in Egypt, and in particular the Sisi. What is the role of Sisi in combating the reactionary forces, including the Muslim Brotherhood, and how is Egypt reconfigurating geopolitically after the revolution of the 30th of June?
More questions? Maybe yeah. Mohammed can take two or three questions. Speak up or speak in the microphone.
Ik heb nooit de moslimbroederschap, beweging en die revolutie en de verkiezingen goed begrepen. Maar ik begrijp nog minder op dit ogenblik waarom dat zoveel intellectuelen, Egyptische intellectuelen, Arabische intellectuelen, de militaire staatsgreep en dictatuur van Sisi ondersteunen.
Good. First of all, I will start with his question and then I will go with the other comrade question. The Muslim Brother Party, the Muslim Brotherhood Party, whether it is in Turkey, Jordan, Tunisia, and Egypt, politically and economically, they are not for national independence. They are for capitalism, globalization. Yes, they have certain tactical differences among them in economics, but their aspiration was to create an economy, a capitalist economy, a state-controlled economy to a certain extent, like Malaysia. That is one. Which also in Turkey, in the beginning, the growth of the economy under this Muslim Brotherhood AKP was very high. And it had influenced a lot of intelligence in the Arabo-Islamic world. For simple reason. Most of these countries are rich countries with poor people. If there will be a Muslim Brotherhood in Portugal, already is poor, it will be even poorer. There is nothing in Portugal except stone. Egypt is a rich country. When you have a human resources that Egypt have, the intelligentsia capacity it have, the technical capacity it have, any small liberal injection in Egypt will bring a lot of change in Egypt, yes. The same in Turkey. But the Muslim Brotherhood in a society, in the Arab society, it also divides the Arab nation. It is a sectarian party. Imperialism understood that. If the Muslim Brotherhood in Jordan, or anybody, anyway, Jordan itself, the king also, and so on, it is a rubbish place. But anyway, if it is happens, Arabs constitute Muslim, Christian, and Jewish. Then you bring a division in the Arab family. In Egypt means a constant conflict among Coptic Egyptians and Muslim Egyptians. Second, it breaks the constitution of Egypt, which says that it is everybody is Egyptian. And if he have a contradiction with constitution because he is a Muslim or a Christian, he have to deal with it with his Allah or God. What is my problem with that? Let him. I have never met his Allah or God. We are Egyptians. We live in this land. So it brings division. Yes, a good number of intelligentsia in the process after 1970s. The reactionary forces, Sadat and so on, reverse again. Another generation was grown up. As Egyptians, they said, لِكُلِّ رِيحٌ, for every wind, it has its time. For every generation, have its time. The generation, 70% of the generation in Egypt today, are brought up by a very bad mother and a father. They are not the generation of my generation, and they are the majority. Second, ideas come from outside. It doesn't come from the womb of the mother. Progressive Arab movement are forbidden. They have no chance, they have no money, they cannot put satellite, they cannot, and so on. Workers' party. Workers are poor. But the sentiment in Egypt shows that they are, the Egyptian people are ready for a change and also ready for a new thinking. And here it comes. The homework must be made by those forces who are doing this job, have to pay the homework. They have to do their homework. The subjective factor is missing there, and I don't know now how it was going on. Second, the intelligentsia, you can divide them in different types. The upper intelligentsia is part of the bourgeoisie. It benefits from the system. They are children of the comprador bourgeoisie. And they just want a cosmetic change. But independent Egypt is not bad. This is not even a class who produce. It is a parasite class. And the revolution must base itself on a real classes. The peasantry, the workers, the big number of the petit bourgeoisie who is working as teachers, as nurses, as doctors, and so on. These are the realistic class in the society. And once you unify them and you bring them an ideas, and you organize them democratically, and you show them the direction, they can make a big difference. Of course, I have put in all the obstacles the Egyptian society is facing. They fight them through drugs, they fight them through films. I forgot one thing, that the film industry in Egypt had been hijacked very long time ago. Egypt had, in 1920s, started the Egyptian television, film. Like Omar al-Sharif and all this came from that. Egypt had a very strong film industry. Now, if you look to the Egyptian film industry, it's dead almost. It became like an Indian industry. It's in India, it starts like this. You are poor, and you become rich. And the rich becomes poor. And they call it waqt. Waqt means time. Only time makes people poor and rich. It's not class, or it's not this. So the Indianization of the film, the infiltration of the film, the weakening of the Egyptian film, the seniors becoming more commercialized. They just want to make money quick. So it is, this is, and the popular class, the popular artist, the patriotic artist, and so on and so on, are marginalized, as the country itself as a whole marginalized. But people have to have their own experience. What I am happy is, imperialism also is weakened. Its tools are known. It tried to use some young people through Twitter and so on, so on, so on, so on, but it is not. Imperialism, the election, if you look, the result of the election of the Egyptian people by itself is a mirror. You can predict what Egypt is going on. Try to find, Google it, and see the election and the people who are voted and the parties who are voted, the concentrate. If you see the behavior of the peasant in Egypt, the poorer peasant, big part of the peasant, the landless peasant, and so on, you will be surprised. The anatomy of Egyptian society, you can read it from there. Sisi and his group. Sisi, he is playing like Charlie Chaplin. You need such kind of people in history. In one side, he moves, of course, again, it's the Muslim Brotherhood, he did this. In one side, he moves, he goes to Moscow, he goes to China, he goes this, he have another stand, and so on and so on. In one other side, he have an alliance with the Wahhabists, and so on. They pay him money, and this and this. And inside the country, also sometimes, he goes left and right. Do you know what is tap dancing? Well, he is a very good tap dancer. But tap dancing is not a solution. I read his dancing from his dancing. What forced him to be a tap dancer? Why he cannot be typical militarist and security element like his predecessor? Because the people of Egypt cannot accept anymore. And he knows that he will collapse. So he is sitting in a heat. And he doesn't know this heat from where it's coming. Because it comes from a lot of angles. Because for that factor, he is a dancer. Don't look to him. Look behind the chair, the heat. In one side, there is some terrorist attacking in Egypt, which he wants to use, and says that the Egyptian people, these terrorists, Al-Qaeda and so on, they are creating problem and division in Egypt. To give you an example, there was a holiday of the Coptic Orthodox Church, and he went to the Patriarch and so on, and he was in the television, he was making a speech. If you read the speech of him, you hear the speech. For me, I was happy. I'm happy not because he went to the church or the mosque. His speech tells you the consciousness level of the Egyptian people. He cannot rule as before. The mechanism of repression is not possible for him. He goes back sometimes to Nasser's idea to forge Egyptian nationalism. He says, we are one. Well, if he makes propaganda for me, saying that we are one, it's good. We are one, yes, we are one. And we want to be one. But what forced him to say this while his predecessor was dividing? Because the level of the consciousness, the struggle in Egypt, is changing every single minute. That's why I said Egypt is pregnant. At any moment, the baby will come. Probably tomorrow, after tomorrow, I don't know. But that baby, they want to make it disabled. I don't think Egyptian mother will deliver a disabled child. It will deliver a healthy, a brave child. And that brave child will change the region. I'm thinking in the term, I'm from the region. If Egypt comes back, Iraq will come back, Somalia will come back, Yemen will come back. We don't need anybody. Egypt's power is important for us. At the end, we are all Egyptians. This is the slogan I put. Egyptians, Egyptians, without Egyptians, no Palestinians. The mother of everybody is Egypt. Because of Egypt, that it is today, Palestine is like this. PLO was kicked from Jordan, kicked from Lebanon 1982 to Tunisia. And now the Zionists, they want to kick all the Palestinians to Brazil and Argentina, which they didn't succeed. But the torch will be in Egypt. And we have to concentrate in Egypt and analyze in Egypt properly. And if you have other questions, I will answer. I hope I answered. Did I answer your question?
We have seen the past for the past 5 years the Syrian state collapsing. Where do you put the Egyptian state in that equation, the civil war with within Syria and Israel between Syria and Egypt? How do the Egyptian military class and other classes see the almost collapsing of the Syrian state within geopolitical terms?
It is from the enemy side. Putin strategical decisions. Their strategical decision is things will not continue like they want. The anchor of US imperialism in the Arab and African world is Egypt. The anchor. When Clinton came to power, his security advisor, Anthony Lake, he created an idea. And he designed the US strategy. He divided Africa in four bases. He says for Northern Africa, from Cairo until Mauritania, the anchor state will be Egypt. Through Egypt, we will influence and control this area. For the greater Eastern Africa, the anchor state will be Ethiopia. Through Ethiopia, and using Ethiopia, we will dominate this region. For Western Africa, they designated to Nigeria. And for South Africa, Southern Africa, South Africa of Mbeki. Where are these anchor states now? Oh, they disappeared, they melted like a Belgian ice cream. You can write your wishful thinking in paper, but we are dealing with reality, with human being. We are not dealing with paper, we are not dealing with ice cream. The second thing is that the liberal Islam, a la Malaysia, a la Erdogan, will replace with the Muslim Brotherhood and create and integrate the region to globalization. Globalization equals to means imperialism and domination imperialism. And Islam will be reformed and it will be democratic. It will be even a Calvinist Protestant Islam combination. I mean, a mulatto of the two. But it failed. And to do that, I'm coming to your question, and to realize that, you have to remove the obstacles. And one of it is that you have to remove the Syrian Baath Party. The Egyptian Muslim Brotherhood incubated from outside and inside of the regime of Sadat and Mubarak, they created a social basis and so on in Egypt for a very long time. Finally, even they joined Mubarak's parliament. They recruited the best element in the Egyptian, they did social work, and so on and so on and so on. They only developed also, they put uniform to their members, including beard. In Syria, the Muslim Brotherhood of Syria came from the landlord class. In Egypt came from the bourgeoisie, and from the higher intellectual bourgeois class. And it believes the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt not to take power by army, but by election, by doing a lot of social works. In Syria, the Muslim Brotherhood came from the landlord, who have lost the land because of the land reform. And ideologically became a primitive and a militarist organization. With foreign terrorists and with this landlord class in the name of the Muslim Brotherhood and all the others and so on, they waged the war. When they waged the war, their calculation is simple for imperialism. They are like children. Simpson film, you know this for the children they put? They have also their own Simpson film for themselves. They put a light to themselves and they enjoy it and they believe it. They believed it in a sense, the regime in Syria is a minority Alawite regime. When we push it, within 3 months the ice cream will melt. And the young man, we have educated him in London and so on, he likes it to be party, according to their analysis of intelligence service of them, the Syrian army will collapse, and Syria will collapse, and we will make cantons. But today, United States is begging for ceasefire. Turkey is begging for ceasefire. Situation changed. The terrorists are defeated. 80,000 foreign terrorists are fighting in Syria. When recently, 2-3 days ago, they made a propaganda near to Aleppo and they are asking the people to move to Europe because Mama Merkel is waiting for them. She loves them. In Arabic, they write with her photo. They want to depopulate the area But militarily and strategically, they have lost. One factor I tell you, Arabs, they are not Mustafas of yesterday. Those who think that, they can go to hell. Arabs are not Mustafas of yesterday. Kissinger says, in 10 years' time, the Zionist state Israel will disappear. Not because Arabs fight them, because of the contradiction within that Zionist society, a racist system. Look, the brave Palestinian, without anything, with knife. I was watching the Belgian television, to conclude, and they showed several Israeli generals, including Shabat and Mossad, previous generals and intellectuals. One of the internal security of Israel general, former Israel general, he says, and he mentions, war is politics with other means. I wage war on you in order to realize my wish on you. But if I cannot realize my wish, your war have no meaning. You cannot continue fighting. We are human beings. We are not ants. Only ants fight until they destroy each other. And he says, Israel needs a solution. It has to take, it is reality. Read Israeli historians what they are writing now. The recent book of Ilyan Papp on Israel. A lot of Israeli progressive books. Better than these imperialist intellectuals. They speak reality. I think Syria, for the imperialists, Syria's situation now is no more of melting up. The issue is that now how to bring the others, which means those who are defeated in the round table. I believe that Syrian army have a very good experience now. Can you imagine, for 5 years, a national army is supposed to fight another army, is fighting a guerrilla war. Syrian army now accumulated an experience better than German army, British army, Israeli army, any army in the world. I salute them. Thank you.